the first question was time sharing multiplexing, space sharing multiplexing. So time sharing is CPU scheduling. In real world, the time scheduling example that we gave was same classroom, but different people using the classroom. Space sharing is multiple address spaces in the memory can be at the, you can have multiple addresses, space corresponding to different processes at the same time. So that's the example of space sharing. Three goals of OS for memory management: transparency in the sense of virtualization. So the user never knows, gets to know how much, so where the actual address is. So that's abstracted out. So you've broken the link between the user addresses and the physical addresses. Efficiency in terms of low time and space overheads and isolation. You want to protect the processes from each other. Okay, third question. This was, so int I equal to 2, return equal to 4. If return is not equal to 0, it means it's the parent process, right? Because the parent gets the return code of the PID of the child. So if return is not equal to 0, you wait or none, which means that you're waiting on the child process. You print the address of I. Now the address of I should be printed as the virtual address, not the physical address. So after setting the question, I was thinking, I could have made it trickier. I could have added V and TA and then asked this question. So what will be printed is 0x 100100, which is the VA of address of I. I equal to 4 printf, I should print. Sorry, so this will not get executed. First, the child will get executed. Sorry about that. So first, print the address of I. This is 0x 100100. I equal to 3. So I is set to 3 now. And then you print I. Now this I setting to 3 is not going to impact anyway the I setting to 3 the other in this parent process. So print 3. When the child completes, the parent is executed, you're waiting for it. Print the address of I, so the same as before. And 4 is then printed because the value of I was set before. So this question is again interesting in the sense that if we are now doing it over multiple threads, so if we were having this kind of a code over multiple threads, will we see the same address of I? So, will we see the same address of I? No. Why? So multiple threads have their own stack. And I is going to be put up on the stack. So each of them have their own stacks. They get a different address. Okay, question 4. One, when are the base and bounds register set up? So they're set up during either the process creation or context switch. So both of them have a fairly similar role. What happens to them during a context switch? During a context switch, we swap out the values of base and bounds, put the base and bounds of the new process. And why is it called dynamic relocation? First, it's the base and bounds are not set up during the compile time. So the OS can then move them up and down wherever they want. That can also happen later, not during the start time, the compile time. Question 5. Okay, so base is 1000, bounds is 300. So if you remember the base and bounds approach, we assume that the virtual address starts at 0. So that's a key thing to remember. So if you have a virtual address of 1000, 1000 is greater than the bounds, right? 300. So that's going to be invalid. Similarly with 1200, 1200 greater than 300, invalid. But 200 is less than 300, so you can find the physical address as the base plus the offset, which is 1000 plus 200, 1200. Any doubts now?
Okay, pros and cons of base and bounds, segmentation, paging.
So the pros of base and bounds, it's quick, simple, only involves two registers. Solve the purpose. Cons is you require the entire contiguous block of memory. So that leads to fragmentation. Now in order to solve fragmentation, we use segmentation, which breaks the code. So you don't require that entire contiguous block, but you require contiguous blocks of these segments. So it addresses fragmentation to some extent, but the con is not is that still doesn't exist, address it fully. Paging has the advantage that it almost eliminates fragmentation because now you're giving fixed size units. It also makes the process easier because you have fixed size units. In terms of cons, the overheads are huge in terms of any memory access. So in order to reduce those overheads, we have paging plus TLP. The con is that those overheads are reduced for the common case. When if an entry is found in the TLP, we don't need to go to the physical memory and look it up. But the cons are that still the Bayesian plus TLB approach requires, has a huge memory overhead. Memory overhead in order to store the paging page tip. So multi-level paging overcomes that, where we try to reduce the space taken by the page, its page table itself. But then the con is that in order to reduce space, we have to increase the time taken.
Okay, so we have 16-bit VA space, 16 KB VA space, and we have 5 segments. So 16 KB can be represented via 14 bits.
We have 2 KB required. How many bits? So 16 by 2 by 2. 16 by 2 requires. So what we now require to do is, so we have 3 segments, 5 segments, each of them is 2 KB. So, and we have 5 segments. So 5 segments require how many bits? 3 bits, right? So we can have, let's, for the keys, let's put segment 1, 2, 3, 4, 0, 0. These are the three most significant bits which help us decide the segment number, and the lesser 12 significant bits which give us the offset into the segment as such, or the bounds of the segment. These will vary from 0000 to 11 till 1111. So for each of these we have something similar. This was all we added in the question. Nothing complicated. Okay, question 8. How do we use segmentation to share memory access, to share memory across processes? So segmentation allows us to have different privileges or protection bits for each of the segment. So for some segments, which are like the code segment, we can set them to be read-only, and multiple processes can then have the same physical memory location for that particular segment. So that's how we can save some space. So we can reduce fragmentation, but now if we allocate each byte of VA to each byte of PA, yes, that's true, we can do that. But it's a bad idea, because then we require to, we have to store that mapping somewhere. And that overhead is going to dominate over the benefits that we're getting of zero fragmentation. Okay, so 65 bytes address space, this can be represented using 6 bits. What is the smallest and largest page size that we can have for this address space? So we have from 0, 0. So assume each of these entry is its own page. And this is 64 entries. So if each of these entries is its own page, then what's the page size? 1, right? And if we have a single page, all of these entries are in a single page, then what's the page size? 64, right? So the page size varies from 1 to 64. Other way to look at it is, so we can have, we always have VPN and offset, which combine to create the address, right? So we, when we have this occupying all the 6 bits, so we have, which means 64 virtual page numbers. So that means the offset is access 0. We require, so the page size is 1. If we do the other way around, we have a single virtual page number. So everything is in the offset. Okay, so what is the corresponding number of pages? How does internal fragmentation? So in this case, when we have a single, when we have a page size of 1, what's the fragmentation? It's almost 0 fragmentation, right? And the memory over it, it's going to be huge, right? Because for each of these pages, now we need to create a page table entry. Each of that maybe requires 4 bytes or 8 bytes. Okay, so if we have that entire block as a single page, then we can have a lot of internal fragmentation because we can have missing entries there.
Question 10, when does a linear page table waste memory?
So it wastes memory when we have a lot of missing entries in the table. How does a linked list overcome this? Linked list overcomes this by keeping only those entries in the linked list which have a valid mapping. So you don't have to store the entire page table. And at what expense does this reduction in memory usage come? So it comes at the expense of increased search insert operations. Because now you have to traverse the entire list.
Okay, how many things have got this question correct?
11th one. This was probably the only tricky question in the quiz. So virtual address can be expressed in 32 bits. Each page is 1024 bytes. Let's start with this. This is 34 bits. Now each page is 1024 bytes. So how many bits do we require to represent 1024 bytes? 10, right? Assume that we are using a single page table, linear page table. In that case, we'll have a VPN and an offset. This will be 10 bits. This will be 22 bits. So we are using, at this point of time, if we are using a single linear page table, then the number of entries required are 2 raised to power 22, right? So it will look something like this one. That's the huge page table that we'll require. And assume that each of them requires 4 bytes, 8 bytes. So it's a lot of overhead per process. That's why we don't use this. Okay, so how many page table entries, how many page table entries can be stored in a single page? So each page is now 1024 bytes. This is our page. So this is our page table which we are now storing in the memory. It has multiple of these page table entries. Each of them has a VPN, a PFN, valid invalid protection, other bits. So each of this takes 8 bytes. 8 bytes. How many such page table entries can we have in one? Can we have in one page? 1024 divided by 8, right? 2 to the power 7 or 128. So we have 128 entries here. So we have 128 PTEs in each page. And this total is 2 raised to power 22, right? Now if we want to break it down into another level, so that we can have lesser memory over it. So what we do is for each of these pages, and this is also a revision for you, so in case some of you didn't understand multi-level paging, you should pay attention. So each of these page, which now contains 128 PTEs, will have a single entry in the next level. So how many entries will now be there in this level? So it is reduced by the number 2 raised to power 7, right? So this had 2 raised to power 22 entries. Now for each
2 raised to power 7 entries, you have a single entry in this next level directory. So the number of entries in this is 2 raised to power 22 divided by 2 raised to power 7. Does it make sense? So what we've now effectively done is offset was 10 bits. You have, let's say, level 1, just 7 bits, and you're still left with 15 bits. Now this has 2 raised to power 15 entries. Again, we do something similar. We put 0.28 PTEs in each of these pages, and we repeat the same procedure. So we again try to, for each page now, we reduce, we put a single entry in the next level. So then we'll have, in this level 1 and level 2, we'll have 2 raised to power 15 divided by 2 raised to power 7 entries. So which effectively means that we now reduce 10 offset. Level 1 is 7, level 2 is 7, level 3 is now left with 1. So all of them will now fit into a single entry. Sorry. This is 15. So this gets broken into 8 plus 7. The 7 comes here, then this 8 gets broken into 1 plus 7. This is clear. The outermost level will fit into a single page. So this will never fit into a single page. This requires 2 raised to power.
If I'm doing 7771, then is that wrong?
So seven, if you do 7771 in this one bit, what do you get? So we move from left to right. So that's the order. But can we use that one bit to?
If I do 777 after 3 levels, I'll have two page tables.
Mm-hmm.
From that one bit, I can choose which page to.
So now at this time, so if you just look at this particular table, this has 2 raised to power 22 entries, right? So we can't use a single page or a single bit to decide which of these entries to pick.
Mm-hmm. So what you are doing is you are clubbing 2 to the power 7 pages.
Mm-hmm.
And then assigning them one value.
Right.
So what I will do is I'll take 2 pages and I'll assign one bit which page to choose. So after doing 777, I'll have 2 options for
Mm-hmm.
Either to choose page A or to choose page B.
So you'll have something like this. Are you saying this?
Only 2 pages. From the last.
So if you have only 2, so this totally requires a lot of pages, right?
Yeah.
This requires 2 raised to power 22 by 2 raised to power 7 pages. So can you choose only 2 of them?
If I have one way to.
But that's not valid, because you want to address all of these.
Yeah, I address all of these. I'm saying just reverse the order 7 instead of 1777.
Right, so what I'm saying is if you move to the, if this particular bit allows you to pick up only 2 pages, but you want to address 2 raised to power 15 pages, how can you do that?
2 raised to power 22 pages.
2 raised to power 22 pages.
So, I'll do it like, first.
So, let's take this offline.
Okay.
We'll move ahead now. Okay, question 12. You want me to solve this? Or is it simple enough? Simple enough, right? Okay. And by the way, this is the dark mode. And also lead some volunteers today to help me out. So this is basically a revision of the previous lecture only. Okay, so we studied
some CPU trends, and we saw that the core frequency is not increasing any longer.
So there have to be new ways or better ways so that we can still increase the performance. We saw two different ways, hyper-threading versus multi-core. Hyper-threading, the example which we can use to remember is that let's try and see that we're trying to increase the speed of our eating. So while a mouth has a limited capacity, but we can coordinate between our arm and a mouth so that we can maximize the eating speed. Multi-core is equivalent of having multiple mouths. So now how do we do this parallel processing or increase the speed of processing? So the first strategy is to use multiple processes. Google Chrome, we saw the example. But then they need, these different processes need to communicate in some way. So they do it via IPC, which could be files, pipes, or some other mechanism like chain memory. One downside is that we have multiple copies of the address space. We saw the second strategy, which is to use threads, which is similar in notion to processes, but they can also share the address space, which means that they can share the base table. They do not need to communicate via IPC because they have some shared resources or shared memory. And another advantage is that we have a single copy of the address space. So when we talk about threading, instead of having a virtual space with a single stack, now we transform it to, for each of the thread, we can have a different instruction pointer because they can be executing completely independently of each other, and each of them will also have a stack pointer. So this is a question which I was asking in the beginning. So if you have two different stacks, if you have variables declared and two different threads, so they'll have different memory locations. We saw an example when we disassembled a piece of code where we were doing, I think, x equal to x plus 1, something on that lines, and we had multiple threads trying to increase that counter. We saw that we saw different schedules, and we saw how we can fall into the trap of not being able to get the correct value. So let's say this is one particular thread. And thread 1 is one particular schedule. Thread 1 is executing. You move the value in this memory location to the register EAX. You increment it, and you move it back to this location. So if this schedule is followed, you move this value to EX, EX becomes 0. Next time you increment, EX becomes 1. Next time you move this value of EX back into the memory location. Now there is a context switch. The other thread that has its own EAX, so it has its own set of registers, similar to how different processes communicate. So each of them will get its own accumulator and different registers, independent of the others. So at this point, EX is undefined. You move the value in this location to EX, it becomes 1. You add 1, it becomes 2. Store it back into the memory location becomes 2. We saw a different order, where the first few lines are the same, but before we are able to move the contents of EX back into this memory location, there is a context switch. So before we were able to write the value, there is a context switch. Now thread 2 begins. Reads the value, which is the old value, because we've not been able to update it to this location. We add 1 to it, EX for thread 2 becomes 1. We write it back to this location, this memory location now becomes 1. We have another context switch. The EX for register for thread 1 was 1. You write it back, it remains at 1. So instead of having the value 2, this remains at 1. In terms of timeline, this is the execution order. We see that the memory location has value 2. But if this is the timeline, that before we are able to write the value back, there is a context switch, the value will be 1. And then there can be various different orders. So what we instead want is atomicity, which means that all of these three instructions either execute in one go for a particular thread, or none of them execute. This notion is called atomicity, and we'll see this in databases also. And this particular section is called critical section. So in many of the cases, you'll see this kind of critical section. You move something into a register, you update the register, you have to store back the value of the register into the memory. Fairly common. And what we want is a technical term called mutual exclusion, which means that if thread 1 is executing the critical section, thread 2 can't execute. Okay, so we'll now practice some questions on pen and paper, and I'll ask one of you to, for each of these questions, to come up and solve them. Okay, so this is a very simple question. It only gets tougher from now. Anyone wants to solve this? So let me show you loop.s. So this is how this particular assembly looks like. Is it clear now? You subtract 1 from the register dx. You test if dx is equal to 0. And jump if greater than or equal to the top. So don't bother about the top, main, and hot stuff. Just look at only these 2 lines. Okay, so fairly simple. What's the value of dx? How does the value of dx vary? We have a single thread at this point in time. So what's the value of dx? How does it vary? Let's say it starts with 0. When you subtract 1 from it, it becomes minus 1. You test it out, it doesn't vary. And the other lines also, dx doesn't vary. And all of the questions in the textbook, so if you want to see how to solve them, just put a minus C flag. 0, minus 1, minus 1, minus 1. Make sense? So does this code have any critical section? No, right, because you're not reading anything from the memory, updating and storing it back into the memory. Let's look at the second question. So it's the exact same question, just that now we have 2 threads and multiple loops. So this is repeated multiple times. So it's going to tell me the value of dx.
So dx is 0 in this
one? Yeah, let's assume it's 0 at starting. Are these? And come from? Just write them over here. Initially 0. And you can speak them, you can speak as you think.
Yeah, subtracting minus 1, then testing doesn't change. Jump to top at 0, no, we are not jumping. Then we have to subtract 1.
It remains at minus 3, nothing changes. It's the same thread, so it's the exact same code. Yeah.
We have same pointer for this.
So
it must subtract minus 1.
Will it be minus 5?
I think so.
Okay, so how many of you think it should be minus 5? The theme correct? No? So it's initialized within the thread. Should it be minus 5, should it be 0, should it be minus 1? So it will be minus 1 because each thread has, so dx is actually a register, so that's what we need to remember. It's not a memory location. So it's, the registers are not being shared, and this register also starts from the same value. So let's say it was this was I equal to 0 in this particular thread. Similarly, we add I equal to 0 in this thread. So we'll have minus 1, minus 1, minus 1. Thank you. Okay, so another, I don't want to call any other placement points, guys. Thank you. and the others can also think in the meanwhile. So now what's happening is, so it's similar to the program that we had earlier, where I was showing that different thread orderings can produce different results. But the question is, will we have that result here or not? So you can directly solve, write the last value, you can write the entire thing.
In the beginning, if it's 0, then it'll be minus 1, then it'll change. And then the initial value in the DX register will be 0.
Yeah.
So, in the DX register, it'll be 0. Then we have a minus 1.
Yeah, so we get the registers are loaded with new values, but those have to be stored somewhere. That's stored in somewhat similar to process control block or thread control block. Yeah, so the program is longer, but I think you'll notice that, so it doesn't matter how these threads are being interrupted and being executed, the final answer will be the same because there is no critical section. Okay, so now let's look at this program. Says that you assume Vx has a loop component, and they also mention the critical section. So for now, assume that they're not telling you where the critical section is. You have to find that. You move the value of 2000 memory location into Vx, add 1 to it, move the value of Vx back into location 2000. So fairly simple, similar to what we'd be doing in the classes one, and to see if they're still looping or not. So let's not bother about looping for now. Okay. So we have a single thread, and we have to tell the value of the memory location to know. So 2000, this is the, so we have to tell the, what's stored at address 2000. So at this point, if you add 1 to AX, nothing happens at location 2000, right? Yeah, so you wrote X plus 1. Yeah, we have to write the value at location 2000. Oh, sorry, I didn't know that. But you see that the value remains the same, right? Okay, so.
Yeah, so yours matches perfectly. It starts with 0, 1, 2, just opposite it by 1 place.
Good. Again, you have to, it's the same program. Let's say X is 0 in the beginning. And you can speak as you think.
Zero. One. One.
AX becomes 2, but the location column still remains 1. And if you're facing difficulty, you can also write the value of AX.
If that helps you.
Same code.
Sorry?
Yeah, so that's what you have to tell me. So what we're trying to do is we're moving the contents of address 2000 into AX. The contents of 2000 are 3, right? So it remains 3. So this is how you need to understand that. Now, this particular program has the notion of shared data. So the location 2000 is shared between the different threads. So it remains 3 and now 4. Yeah.
And if you solve this, you can see that.
So I think you should maybe even put the value of AX thread 0 and AX thread 1. That will be easier. You can write somewhere else. And you'll have two different AX if you remember. So each of the thread will have its own. So the trick here was that we've actually have a race condition now. So at this point of time, not at this point. It's still fine. Why is it 2? So you put the value of 2000 at this point of time is put into AX. So AX 2 is 1. You increment it. Put 2 there.
Fairly simple, right?
And you can now verify that.
I don't know.
If you see that this is the interesting bit, you move the value of 2000 to AX, you increment it in, on the other thread, you store the new value of AX into 2000 from the other thread, but before you incremented one, you already have the value of the older 2000 address in the register AX. So that's why it won't pick up, it won't do X plus 1 plus 1, it will just only do X, just pick up this point. So it's not only that you've read and you've not been able to write, but even if you've read and it's not incremented, so then also you can have this case of race condition.
So the last question. That's not a good random suit. No, neither is this one. Yeah, Sahith.
Sahith or
Sahith?
Sahith. Without forming even the cell, the correct value. But it leads to race condition, where will the race condition occur? Whichever is better. Somewhere you would have 1, right? You have all 0. So let's say 2000 was 0 to start with, you added 1. So AX for this thread now becomes 1. You can write AX 0 as 1 at this point. You move back from thread 1 to location 2000, it again remains 1, it doesn't become 2.
We'll now look into something called locks. So the idea is that we want to ensure mutual exclusion between threads. So we basically say that one thread locks the critical section and its
the only thread which is allowed to execute at this point. So let's say the thread one at this point checks if the lock is free or not, or basically this, if any other thread is holding the lock or not. If the lock is free, then thread one says that, you know, I can acquire the lock. It says that I have locked this particular critical section. Only a short while after thread one has acquired the lock, we have thread two which says that, you know, I want to execute this critical section. But then it again has to check if the lock is free or not. It finds out that the lock is not free. So it does not execute till the lock becomes free. It keeps on hanging at this particular execution point. Now thread one executes, it completes its operation, it unlocks, and while sequentially it seems that this happens, this particular thread starts at this time, it will effectively start when this particular section has ended and the thread one has unlocked. And then thread two again keeps on checking periodically or continuously if the lock is free or not. Since the lock is free, it can now execute its critical section and then it can unlock after it. That's the key idea behind locks. So there are three important goals of a lock. The first, as we've seen, is mutual exclusion, which is that only a single thread can run the critical section at a particular time. We don't want multiple threads to be running. That defeats the purpose. Second is fairness. So this is similar to process scheduling. We want to have goals or notions of fairness, so that each thread will have a fair chance of executing the critical section. The extreme case being starvation. So we want to prevent starvation. And as we've always seen, that we want to have a low time and space over it of this locking mechanism. There are different cases in which we can have different performance over it. One, if we have a single thread, there is no contention. So locking and unlocking will still take some time and space. If there are multiple threads, but they're running on the same CPU, which is similar to the examples we've been seeing thus far, there'll be some over it because only a particular thread will run at a time. Multiple threads, multiple CPUs. So that's the trickiest one. Let's look at one very trivial.
So we have a PPT from 10:10.
10:10. So there are three ways, there's three simple blocks you need to sync in order to build a very simple lock, which is disabling interrupts. So you lock, you disabled all the interrupts. So you were seeing that critical section was getting interrupted because some of the thread wanted to execute. Disable the interrupts, critical section executes. And until and unless this particular section has executed, we don't start the interrupts again. When we restart the interrupts, then some of the thread can also interrupt and it can start. So we'll look at two or three more slides in the lab tomorrow. We'll do some exercises.
Is it disabled all interrupts?
Yeah. So that's about